Welcome to the Cathedral on this fourth Sunday of Advent, the 20th of December. As we join together in worship, we remember the gifts we've been given by God. We remind ourselves that God is loving and generous and always wants the best from us and for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we begin our worship, we confess our sins and failings, knowing that when we do this from our hearts, we will be forgiven. Lord Jesus, too often we have failed to be obedient to your will. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, too often we have failed to use the gifts you have given us or the opportunities we have been sent. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, too often we have done things for our own convenience and not taken account of the needs of others. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy upon us. Pardon and forgive us all our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness and bring us to new life always. Amen. The collect for today. O God, our Redeemer, who prepared the Blessed Virgin Mary to be the mother of your Son, grant that as she looked for his coming as our Saviour, so we may be ready to greet him when he comes again as our Judge, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our readings today, the first reading from the second book of Samuel, David proposes to build a house, as he puts it, for the Lord, but he is told by the prophet Nathan that this is not what is wanted. Instead, he says the Lord will make a house for David, a dynasty that will last forever. Our second reading is the final verses of St. Paul's letter to the Romans. They are a kind of doxology, a kind of hymn of praise, and refer in particular to a mystery held secret for centuries, but now disclosed. Through the grace of God, the revelation of Jesus is for the Gentiles as well as the Jews. And in our Gospel reading, St. Luke tells how the angel Gabriel, fresh from informing the priest Zechariah that his wife Elizabeth will give birth to John the Baptist, now tells an ordinary Galilean teenager called Mary that she will be the mother of the long-awaited Messiah. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. He came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her, who is said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. St. Luke records those words of Mary, "Here am I, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Some 20 years ago, the BBC Everyman programme featured a village church in Hertfordshire telling a story of how in a baptism, the family and indeed all those present had thought that they had seen an angel. In the midst of a baptism service, a small baptism service, it was said that suddenly someone in white appeared at the font. The figure did not have wings, but all those present seemed to think that this was an angel, someone sent by God. The image, the vision, as it were, disappeared soon afterwards. And the vicar described the experience as the most wonderful feeling. He said people began to touch their arms because it felt like having warm liquid poured over their skin. The children came forward with their mouths open, and suddenly the figure was gone. Such stories may seem very odd to us, but they're not uncommon. They're told by very different people in very different circumstances. This one was rather strange and made a television programme, and you can still read about it on the internet, although nobody really knows what happened. That description is interesting, a warm liquid. Did Mary feel as though warm liquid was being poured over her, I wonder, when the angel Gabriel appeared? It's important to remember that she was just a Galilean girl in her early teens and had very little experience of life, of other people, let alone of angels. But God had chosen well. Mary listened intently but wonderingly to the angel telling her what would take place. "You will conceive. It will be a son. You will call him Jesus, who will be the Messiah." Mary was not afraid to ask the difficult question, "How can this be?" What she really made of the angel's answer, she kept to herself. What she really thought about being overshadowed by the Holy Spirit, we will never know. What she thought of the disgrace and stoning she might face when the news of her pregnancy got out, we can only imagine. But she was content with being God's servant. "Let it be with me," she said, "according to your word." The Annunciation, the name we give to that wonderful episode in St. Luke's Gospel, the Annunciation, the announcing of the arrival of God's Son, reminds us that God, by various means, tends to give prior notice of future intentions. God speaks before action is taken. God promises before the gift is given. God warns before the judgment is carried out. The announcements may not always be in clear and precise language, and the history of humankind is in part the failure to understand God's messages. It's because of these promises, these announcements, that Christians through the ages are given hope, the sure hope of glory yet to be. It is because of what God has announced through the prophets and through Jesus that we can live in hope. Hope that God's kingdom will come. Hope that one day all will be well. Hope that one day this pandemic will be behind us. The certain hope of a glory that is yet to be revealed. Yet to be revealed, not yet revealed. The Annunciation to Mary was one of a series of announcements to people in the Bible, but we must not assume that those announcements have stopped. Sometimes God needs to identify people for a task or to perform a function and needs to tell them about it or to nudge them in a particular direction. The message is unlikely to say, "You will be." More likely it'll say, "You could be," or even, "You should be." Perhaps we, any one of us, is being called. Either we don't want to hear the call, or we don't recognize God's voice. Or we do recognize God's voice, but don't want to react to it. It doesn't necessarily mean having a vocation to be a priest or a church worker or a missionary. It may mean being identified, being singled out for a purpose. Mary was singled out. St. Paul was singled out. David the shepherd boy, least of all the brothers, was singled out. If God needs to achieve a particular purpose by singling someone out, it is not a prerequisite for that person to be part of the great and the good. Neither does the purpose need to be dramatic or spectacular, as God's purpose was for Mary. God has much ordinary business to be carried out as well. And it's to us that that ordinary business is given. As we approach this great festival of Christmas, now merely days away, we give thanks for the gift of God's Son. We pray that we might help to carry out his business. Amen. Pray for the church and for the world, knowing that God will hear our prayers. We pray for the church here on earth, in every denomination and in every country. We pray for all missionaries and church workers, for all God's people working in areas of poverty, war, or oppression. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the world and its leaders, that they may resolve the ancient resentments and hostilities that divide races and nations. We pray for those who yearn for rest from violence and destruction. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those whose faith has been weakened or challenged and whose experience of suffering or evil has diminished their faith in God's goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those in pain or distress of mind, body, or spirit, and for those whose world is bleak and dark. We ask the Holy Spirit to comfort and guide into the light of God's mercy and grace all those who suffer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of healing, we ask that you hear all these our prayers. We ask for your reassurance that however far we have strayed, you will welcome us back with outstretched arms and will never let us go. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So we pray together. Ein tad, ar hwnnwyd yn nefoedd, sanctaeddiad y enw, dilyd y dairnas, gwneud y wyllus, megis yn y nef, felly ar y ddau hefyd. Darwini heddiw ein barau bainyddiol, y maddau i ni ein dyledion, fel y maddau yw ninnau i'n dyledwyr, ac nac arwain ni i brofyd i gaeth, aeth ei gwared ni rhag drwg, canis a'i ddod ti yw'r dairnas, a'r gallu a'r gwgoniant yn oes oesoedd. Amen. As we progress through this last week of Advent, we pray that we might be thankful for the gifts bestowed upon us and the opportunities given to us. May we resolve anew to use them for the furtherance of God's kingdom on earth. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.